I'm going to present you a joint work with a biologist. Three biologists from Sorbonne University, Sylvie Schneider, and two former postdoc, Guillaume Pézeron, and then Alice Karam. And also with Frédéric Clément, which is who is in INRIA medicine, and who is also in SEMRAX, in the team with Romain Ivinec, and myself, and Céline, and Keltoum. Okay, so this work was really originated by the biologists. They are studying ciliopathies, which are defects in the brain, in the human brain, and they have built a mouse model for these ciliopathies. And they became convinced that the problem originated as early as the neurogenesis. And so they started to study neurogenesis in the mouse. And let me sketch very briefly what is neurogenesis. It's a very simplified sketch of the real problem. With only three types of cells here, which are represented in red, the apical cells, in green, the apical progenitors, in green, the intermediate progenitors, and in blue, the neurons. But there are much more many types of cells in this process. Okay, here in abscissa, you have the time, and it is the embryonic time, which lasts for the mouse about 20 days. In ordinate, you have, very sketched, the thickness of the cortex, which is in the brain. Okay, and so what you see here, it's at the beginning of the embryo, the apical progenitors just proliferate, and here there is a blow-up of what they do when they proliferate. They move a little during their cell cycle, a little vertically, and when they divide symmetrically to produce two apical progenitors, they spread tangentially to the cortical plate. And about at the middle of the gestation, they start to switch to an asymmetrical division, where they produce either one apical progenitor and one neuron in blue, or one apical progenitor and one intermediate progenitor in green. And so these two other cells, so the neurons, they are differentiated, and they will move vertically to thicken and that will induce the thickening of the cortex. And also the intermediate progenitors move vertically. Okay, and here you have a blow-up of these asymmetrical divisions. So the apical progenitor divides either one and one neuron, or in one intermediate progenitor and one apical progenitor. But here you can have two mechanisms. Either the intermediate progenitor will go for one cell cycle and then divide into two neurons, or at the end of its first cell cycle, it will produce two intermediate progenitors, which then in there will do two neurons each. Okay? But it's about all that can happen. You cannot have more divisions of intermediate progenitors. Well, you can have, because nothing is fixed in biology, but it's about the two mechanisms that are observed. Either one cycle in intermediate progenitors or two in a row. So, okay, you can summarize this by introducing all these divisions. Okay, so the red, it's the apical, the green, it's the two type of intermediates. The one that will produce directly neurons, we call neurogenic intermediate progenitors in dark green, and the light one, the proliferative intermediate progenitors, and then in blue, the neurons. Okay, there have already been some mathematical modeling of neurogenesis, but the earlier works from the team of Cavines, they consider all the progenitors together, the apical plus the intermediate, and they do compartmental models. And in this team of biologists in 2011, they started to distinguish among the intermediate progenitors, the proliferative and the neurogenic, and they found a technique to experimentally visualize them. And then starting from this work, there was some mathematical modeling done using stochastic processes, but they never came to the point to match the model with the experimental data sets. So that was a little the situation when we started to work. And okay, we spent a lot of time with the biologists to design the model with them. We wanted to do a data-driven model, that is to take into account all the data they would be able to acquire. So that's how they work, okay? Here you have a picture of the brain in the embryo, of the embryo, and okay, they are able to select a zone and to take sections of this area. Of course, this is at embryonic day 14, okay? Before that, it was not the same shape and the same size, and then after that, the brain is going to expand more. But they can always, during this geometrical okay, they can always select back this same area. And it's an area about 2 millimeters square. And they take measurements at a regular time sample every day or half day. Of course, it's never the same embryos and it's never the same mouse. But it's important to be regular in time. And then in these sections, maybe I am too. Do you see the red spot? I don't see it anymore. Okay. Here. They stain, they do immunostaining of the sections with different antibodies, and they are able to identify 4 different types of cells. Even more, but the one which are interesting are in green the apical progenitors, in red the intermediate progenitors, and among those, if they look at two antibodies, they can identify the proliferative intermediate progenitors, the IPPs, and the neurons, and they can also do another staining to identify the cells which are on the point of divisions in the mitotic stage. So, to explain all this data, we have designed a model where, okay, I forgot to say that in fact, this data from the cell, they stain the cells and then they count them manually. It's a very long process and very time consuming. They are able to obtain cell counts at each time sample, for each time sample. But this sampling from the apical progenitors, they are not really useful because of what I explained earlier, that the apical progenitors spread tangentially, so they go outside the experimental design section. And so we cannot really use these numbers. On the contrary, the intermediate progenitors and the neurons, since they spread vertically, radially from the cortical plate, accurate cell count. So we don't use the apical progenitor dataset. We treat it as an unknown. In fact, inputs, it's also unknown. It's the inputs of the model. It will be the flux of apical progenitor cells which enter the process, and two ratio of divisions. So the percentage of cells of apical cells which divide into one intermediate progenitor, and 1 minus beta, it's the percentage which produce directly neurons. That's called direct neurogenesis. And another division rate, the gamma, so a percentage of those intermediate progenitors are proliferative, so they will proceed one cell cycle, then divide into two intermediate progenitors, which then will divide into neurons, and there will be 1 minus gamma percentage ratio that will go directly from apical into neurogenic intermediate progenitors and then produce neurons. Okay, and so there are two scales. Of course, these inputs, the flux of apical progenitors, and the division rates can depend on time. This obviously depends on time, since I told you at the beginning. At the beginning, FAP, it's zero, since the AP just proliferates, okay? And then it starts to increase when the AP starts to divide asymmetrically. And then at the end, it stops a little before birth. The apical, two or three days before the birth, the apical progenitors start to produce intermediate progenitors. They produce other types of cells, glial cells, so basically the FAP, you will see, it has a bell shape. And the biologists knew in advance that it would have this shape, zero and then increase and then decrease. But the beta and gamma, they had really no clue what was the behavior in time. So the two scales, it's obviously the time, and then we introduce this other scale, which is the age of the cell within the cell cycle. And you will see, we do this because we want to be able to look closely at what happens during specific phases of the cell cycles, namely the S phase and the M phase, the mitotic phase, because the biologists are able, theoretically able to identify the cells which are in these two phases. And two important parameters, they are therefore the length of the cell cycle, the duration of the cell cycles, which is roughly 1 day, but which is different for the two types of intermediate progenitors, and that was shown by this earlier paper by Arai. So we have numbers from the literature for these two parameters, the two cell cycle lengths. And the output of the models, which we will try to fit with the data, it will be the numbers of neurons and intermediate progenitors. But what the model produces at first, it's a density of cells depending on these two cell cycles, these two variables, the time and the age in the cell cycle. So that's what we call the microscale. The output of these transport PDEs are cell densities. There are two, one for the IPPs and one for the IPNs, the bottom. It's a very simple transport PDE with a speed one, which you can solve with the characteristic method. And what is a little more complicated, it's the link between the transport, the PDEs, which are flux conditions between the cell compartments. So here, on this first slide, you have the flux condition coming from what happened here at the entrance of the IPP compartment. You have the flux of AP multiplied by the two division ratio, the gamma and the beta. So it's here. And for the second type of IPPs, the IPNs, the neurogenic ones, you have cells which come from the division of the first IPPs and cells which come directly from the APs. So the flux condition is the sum of the two. So what comes out of this compartment is multiplied by two since the IPPs divide symmetrically. So here you can see the solution of this system of PDEs in the two scales. So in abscissa you have the time, and in ordinate you have the h, a, and the black lines divide the phases of the cell cycle. And the color code is for the cell density. So blue indicates no cells. At the beginning there is nothing in both compartments. And then for this, so here you see the bell shape for the AP flux. Then the AP start to produce intermediate progenitors, so around 12. So the density of first this compartment starts. Well, also the both start at the same time since gamma is not zero at the beginning. Okay, and if you want now to have the cell counts, which is what the biologists observe, they don't observe cell densities, you have to integrate this solution against age. So you have to sum the vertical, the numbers on one vertical, and you obtain the cell count at a given time. So that's another example of the solution. So that's what we do. The first thing we do, we want to obtain the neurons count. Okay, so what the neurons, they are produced by what comes out of the neurogenic IPs and what was directly produced by the APs in neurogenic, direct neurogenesis. So it's this quantity which has to be integrated on time. And you can also, as I said, integrate over age the two types of progenitors to obtain the cell counts as a function of time. Okay. And the total count of IPs, which is also something that the biologists measure, it's the sum of the two counts. Another thing that we can do, which is one of the interest of introducing this age variable, it's to be able to compute partial cell counts. So that's what we call the intermediate or mesoscale. We can compute by integrating over just a portion of the age window the S cells. And we obtain what the biologists call the labeling index by dividing the number of of cells in S phase by the total number of cells. And so we do this for both type of intermediate progenitors. And in the same manner, we can obtain the mitotic index by counting the cells which are in the mitotic phase. So by the way, this is roughly the scale of the phases length. So I said the total cell lasts about 1 day, and the mitotic phase lasts half an hour. Okay, so now we come to what we really were able to do. So the real data sets. So that's what the biologist gave us in the end, after a lot of work, a lot of counting all these cells. We obtained an Excel sheet with the blue crosses. And okay, we were a little disappointed because we could understand that there were not many points because it's such a hard process to obtain. You have to, okay, it's each point is an embryo brain, okay? So, but you can see that we will not be able to do a priori statistics on the data. There are not enough data. We have three data sets, the count of IP cells, the count of neurons, and the count of proliferative intermediate progenitors, IPPs. And we see also that they are on very different scales, okay? And also there is a different sampling rate because sometimes they did measurements every day, but sometimes they did it every 12 hours. So we started to feel that it would not be so easy to calibrate the model with this data. So we decided to do, yes?
Usually you have an error bar when you have
Error bar.
Yeah,
this is the actual points, the blue dots, the blue crosses are the measurements.
Okay.
So each day you have, there were good days where we had 6 measurements, but there were days where we had only 2 measurements. And so what we did, the black dots, we did the mean of the measurements at a given time. But that was about all we could do because, okay. So we decided, it was very hard already to give weight to each of the data sets because which data set are you going to trust more, okay? And the scale, everything, the spreading of the measurements. So we decided to do a multi-objective optimization by designing this objective function as a sum of these 3 terms. And okay, I could explain more detail, but G star X, it's the best fit for using only one single data set, okay? And G max X, it's the worst fit that you will have. So basically it is computed on the best fit on the 2 other data sets. And we introduce also some weights, time weights, time sampling weights, to take into account these either 12 hours or 24 hours time sampling rate. Okay, and we also reduce our expectations and decide to identify only 2 unknowns, the input flux, FAP, which is already 5 unknowns because it's the strength of the AP flux plus the beginning of the rise, the end of the position of the rise, the position of the decay, and the slope S plus and S minus of the rise and the decay. And we want to identify the gamma coefficients. That's the ratio between proliferative and neurogenic intermediate progenitors. So gamma of T we parametrize as a sigmoid, so it's 4 coefficients. The start, the end, the slope, and the position of the variation. 9 coefficients altogether. We forget about the direct neurogenesis coefficient, beta, because in their experiments, which doesn't mean that it never happens, but in their experiments, they didn't see it. They didn't see the evidence of direct neurogenesis. So we fixed beta equal to 1. Okay. And okay, but still we try to do it carefully. So we started to identify only the FAP flux with the, that's the green line. You must not see it very clearly. So keeping gamma constant, identifying the gamma level, but constant in time, we obtain the green solution. Then we say, okay, at first we didn't use the IPPs. In fact, historically, we didn't have it at first. We had it only recently. So, okay, we identify using only IPs and neurons, we get the green line. Then we let gamma of t vary in time, and we get the blue line. Still, we don't have the IPPs. And then suddenly the biologist arrives and they say, oh, but by the way, we are able to identify the IPPs. And so we have an extra data set and now we have this. Okay, so of course we put it in the fit function and okay, we get the red line, which is of course very different with respect to the IPPs, but not so different with respect to the IPs. But if you look at the input of the models here, it's very different. Okay, so what is interesting in this thing? It's the output of neurons. That's what all this process is about, producing neurons. And you see that the three solutions are. Okay, there is a little difference, but not so big with respect to the big differences in the behavior of the intermediate progenitors. Okay, so let's keep this this best solution we have, which take into account the three data sets. And then we say, okay, but you told us you have this defect that you want to study, which produce the ciliopathies. So they have this, a mutant which is responsible for one type of ciliopathies, which exhibit these ciliopathies. And so we did also calibration on this data set. So now the control data set is in blue, and the red lines correspond to the mutant. And what they had, the beginning of the story was that this they had observed a very big difference when they count the neurons at this specific age, 14, E14. That's about the middle of the neurogenesis. The neuron counts for the mutant was more than half, was very low compared to the control ones. So what the model and the data tells us is that this can be compensated at the end of the neurogenesis, almost compensated by, in fact, it's because the neurogenesis in the mutant starts much later than the control one, for the control one. But it starts later, but it tries to catch up by producing a lot of intermediate progenitors, and it does catches up. It does catch up almost at the end. Okay, I told you the interest, the specificity of our model compared to previous other models. It's the possibility of accessing to this intermediate scale data sets, the labeling and the mitotic indexes. And so, okay, we did this. We didn't have real data, but we still did some experiment. Okay, we compute from the model output, we compute the labeling and the mitotic index. And I have to explain that experimentally, the biologist relate these two indexes to the phases length, the length of the S phase and the length of the mitotic phase, by assuming that they are in a steady state autorenewal regime. And with this model, you can very easily understand how it goes. Like if you imagine that the compartments are full, completely full, and there is a constant influx in input flux of APs. Really, the solution of the model will produce for the mitotic index and for the labeling index the ratio of the two of this length in age and divided by the total length, and or for the labeling the length of the S phase divided by the total cell cycle. So, okay, we wanted to do some pedagogy with the biologist. So we plot here, we plot this value, the ratio of the two of the S phase over the cell cycle, and we plot the labeling index computed by the model, which takes into account that we are not in a steady state. We are not at all in a steady state. Okay, and you see that it is very different. It is equal only in this region where the flux, the top of the bell shape for the flux, for the input flux. Okay, and also it depends on the ratio gamma, the ratio of neurogenic and proliferative intermediate progenitors. So this is quite interesting, and you have the same behavior for the mitotic index. And in these are completely abstract simulations where here we take the gamma ratio constant in time. And if we turn to the actual results that we identify on the data set, here you have the line corresponding to the mitotic, to the labeling index computed by the model, and in dashed line, this theoretical value that it should have if we were in the steady state. But here, gamma of t, gamma depends on time, so the dashed line varies with time. And you see here again, you are very far from the theoretical value. Same thing with the mitotic index. Okay, I think I'm going to stop now, give a few conclusions. So we were able, although the data set were very sparse, we could calibrate it on both the control and the mutant, and we have been able to explain why we have this discrepancy at E14, which is caught up at earlier later times for the mutant. Of course, we would like to have better data sets or more data or better quality, but it's very difficult to acquire. And we are very interested with using these mesoscale indexes to interpret the data sets. Okay, thank you for your attention.